Tonight we have antibiotic resistance with Dr. Warren Rose. He's from the UW-Madison School of Pharmacy. Dr. Rose joined the University of Wisconsin School of Pharmacy in 2007 as an assistant professor in the pharmacy practice division. He was educated at Butler University and then did a residency at Rush University Medical Center in Chicago, and also a postdoc at the Anti-Infective Research Laboratory in Wayne State University in Detroit. Dr. Rose's research involves the microscopic pathogens such as bacteria, fungi, viruses, parasites, and the effects of drugs used to combat those agents on the body. He's interested in multi-drug resistance to these pathogens, and especially the treatment and resistance of methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or MRSA, also known as the superbug. So, here's a little story about Dr. Rose from about 10 years ago. He was working in Detroit, a hotbed, actually, of antibiotic resistance. Who knew? It's one of the few places with resistance to the antibiotic that is used as a last resort to treat the superbug MRSA. While working there, he stuck himself with a needle and developed an infection. Well, as you can imagine, he was moderately freaked out, knowing that the infection might be extremely hard to control. But being a scientist, he quickly calmed down and proceeded to culture his own infection. And he cultured the bacteria from his own infection, and then he tested a whole bunch of antibiotics to see which one might cure his infection. So he had discovered he had a few options, and he brought his findings to his doctor. Excuses now to all the doctors in the room. And he suggested that the doctor prescribe one of the antibiotics that he had identified would actually be effective against this particular infection. What do you think happened? A, the doctor said, "How cool, how innovative. Let's try your idea." And Warren's antibiotic selection worked. Or B, the doctor actually said, "How cool, how innovative. No way we're trying your idea." And the doctor prescribed his own antibiotic. Well, trick question. First B, then A. So the doctor refused to use Dr. Rose's results. But the doctor's choice of antibiotic had no effect. So then he reluctantly agreed to give Warren's a chance, and it worked. So now he is infection-free, as far as we know. You can decide on the moral of this story yourself. Thank you very much, Dr. Warren Rose.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for having me. It's a real pleasure to be up here and talk to you about, I think, an important problem, and I hope that you will develop an appreciation for the problem as well. It's really exciting to be here. I know whenever I was asked to come, I tried to frame an idea around antibiotic resistance and get the idea about how we can do it as a community to try to prevent that problem, and then how physicians and pharmacists and other healthcare providers are working to try to resolve the issue. So we're working on a lot of things. Just a personal plug for any of you that that may be interested in pharmacy or have sons or daughters interested in pharmacy. School of Pharmacy is a really interesting place. We do a lot of innovative things. We have very excellent researchers and teachers, and pharmacy is a very important area for healthcare. So we'd be happy to talk to you more about that if that's something that some of you or your relatives are interested in. So who in here thinks antibiotic resistance is a problem? Who in here thinks that I got amoxicillin, it worked, I don't think antibiotic resistance is an issue? Nobody? So you've been reading the news, apparently. Or just heard my story and now are very interested in it. There was some handouts I was passing around, so I don't know. I see one on the table here, and there's some that are available. So what this is there's been a lot of information in the news about antibiotic resistance, and so the CDC has developed kind of a handbook for the community, basically, and goes through some pathogens that they say are a major problem for healthcare, health in general, not just in the hospital, but also in the community. They have urgent levels of need, and they also have serious threats, And so I printed off those for you that are available, and it actually goes through some interesting information on how many patients have infections per year, what is the problem from a dollar standpoint, you know, what is the economic burden, and then what people can do as a community and what people can do in healthcare to try to prevent the problem. And so I think that's interesting, and I think Hank is going to put it on the website as a PDF that can be downloaded later. It's available by the CDC if you wanted to look for it. So kind of gets to the point of, you know, the CDC is really wanting to get the public knowledgeable about the problem of antibiotic resistance and what we can do about it as a community. So, you know, there are a lot of things that we can do as a community. There's innovative ways to look at antibiotic resistance and try to prevent it. So I think, number one, what are we doing in the hospital setting? One, we're using too many antibiotics. I hope that many of you can appreciate that. So common things that might occur in the hospital that you don't need antibiotics for: people can have a temperature for not having an infection. They can have viral infections for which antibiotics have really no treatment course. And the same thing can happen in the community. So an overuse of antibiotics is really a major problem in that regard. And how these things develop. So I've been asked a couple questions just as a preliminary in the talk is, how does antibiotic resistance develop? Well, I've been speaking to bacteria a lot. Bacteria are simple in a way, but they're also very complicated, meaning they're very smart and they can evade antibiotics very easily. And us as scientists and developers of antibiotics, we're not very innovative, to be quite honest. Bacteria have just a few mechanisms that they use to metabolize and grow and divide, and there's only a few things that science can target to try to modify that effect. And so once resistance develops to one antibiotic, it can transition on to resistance to another antibiotic very easily, even though it may not have ever seen that antibiotic. Another problem is that bacteria typically produce their own antibiotics, so just a common mechanism of evolution to fight off competitors in the growth cycle with other bacteria. They produce antibiotics that fend off other organisms, and scientists manipulate those antibiotics and mass produce them on a scale to treat humans. Just to give you a little relation on how things have evolved in regards to antibiotic development. So many of you, when did penicillin come out roughly for mass production? 1939, it was kind of discovered. And then in the 40s, during the war, it started to be mass produced. And so at the time, everything was susceptible. Within probably 10 years of mass production, you had widespread resistance to a specific bacteria that was used to treat many like skin infections that people from the war were coming home with. And so then we transitioned off to increase the activity, manipulating that antibiotic to make it more effective. And within 2 or 3 years, the bacteria, that same bacteria, had developed resistance to that modified chemical. So then we went to another antibiotic, and within a year, we had resistance that had developed to that other antibiotic. And now when antibiotics come out on the market, you have resistance that's already existing in the population of bacteria, and you have clinical resistance in patients within 1 to 2 years easily, even though bacteria may have never seen that antibiotic. So it gets to the point of, you know, we're not going to stop it. It's a matter of keeping it in check so that it doesn't overwhelm us as a population. So I think the title of the talk was A World Without Any Antibiotics. I don't know that that's ever going to happen. I mean, you'll still have antibiotics that work in the majority of population, but the problem is you have patients, there will be patients that, and there are currently, for which no antibiotic will work. You've read probably some stories in like the New York Times or USA Today, major newspapers that talk about resistance in certain regions of the world. Probably about 5 years ago now, was a publication out of India that showed that there was this resistant bacteria that patients from Europe were going to India to get treated, like from a surgical standpoint. Surgery is much cheaper in third world countries. They would go there to get their cosmetic surgery, pick up the infection, bring it back to England or to Europe, and spread that organism throughout the population. And so, you know, antibiotic resistance is a worldwide problem, and it can happen pretty much overnight from one country to another just because of worldwide spread. But overall, the things that bacteria use to make themselves resistant to antibiotics, it also hurts them from a metabolism standpoint or from a reproduction standpoint, because it's a big burden for them to have a lot of resistance. And so what I'm getting to is that it's hard to transmit from patient to patient, and it's likely not a huge spread problem. It's a matter of keeping it in check from our standpoint. So a little bit of perspective on the matter. before antibiotics were invented, if you would get a skin infection, you probably had about a 20% chance of dying from that infection, so just a minor abrasion infection. If you had pneumonia and had pretty severe pneumonia, you had probably a 60% chance of dying. Now with antibiotics, skin infections, you might have a 1% chance of dying at the most. And with pneumonia, probably a 5 to 15% chance of dying if you seek appropriate medical care. So certainly they've really improved the way we do things. Without antibiotics, certainly we would not be able to maintain function in the hospital. We would have a problem with just treating minor things and doing minor procedures from a surgical standpoint. So having them available is really important. Which kind of gets me to my second point is, well, where are we at with antibiotic development? We're not doing very good. Hopefully that's ingrained in us from what you maybe have heard in the news and the media. Antibiotics, as I mentioned earlier, are very hard to create because bacteria are very simple, and they don't have a lot of targets for which we can target antibiotic development. So once we target a certain mechanism in bacteria, they've already developed resistance by seeing a similar product of antibiotic, and they can mutate very easily, so it's a major problem. Companies don't like to invest in antibiotics. Anyone want to take a guess as to why that is? Money. Exactly. Why money? Yeah. How long do patients get treated with, like, Lipitor? Forever. You have a 50-year-old that's going to live another 40 years on Lipitor. That's a couple thousand a year for the next 40 years in that patient. Antibiotics, you're treating them for 10 days. And yeah, infections happen a lot, but compared to a lifetime of treatment, it certainly does not have the ability to recoup their money as well. So major companies, if you think about major companies in the past that have produced antibiotics, Eli Lilly invented and mass-produced penicillin. They invented cephalosporins like cefalexin. Probably many of you have heard of that drug before. Vancomycin, they invented and produced that drug. Are they in antibiotics anymore? They're in neurology, they're in diabetes, and they're in cardiovascular medicine. They've completely shut down their entire pipeline of antibiotic development. So it just tells you that we're at a problem. Pfizer, pretty big company, don't you think? Zero antibiotics. They're out of the market for antibiotic development. Now, they still do vaccines, which is really important, but they do not do antibiotic development anymore. They've laid off their entire scientific workforce in antibiotic development. Merck is still a very big player. And as well as other companies, and really the innovative things that are coming out into the market are coming from small startup companies, biotech companies, and universities. So universities create or mine the soil for bacteria, mine the oceans for bacteria. And recently at UW, there was a group that is now starting to look at antibiotic development from symbiotic insects that work together in that regard. So finding novel ways to look at antibiotics, but getting them to mass market is going to be a challenge because us as a university or the small companies really don't have the mechanism financially to do the large clinical trials that are needed. Another barrier for companies is the ability to recoup their money because the FDA is also a problem. So the FDA requires very stringent criteria, and probably a good thing. We don't want drugs going out into patients that are going to kill them or do harm to them. They certainly need to be safe. But for antibiotics, that's very difficult to produce and then test. For instance, when you compare Lipitor, I go back to that because many people are probably on it. maybe not here, but other people throughout the world are on it. But certainly that's a very common drug. And so when you compare that drug in a trial, you compare it to a placebo, right? You've probably heard of that term, a drug that's not going to work. So if you have a patient that has an infection and you want to do a clinical trial, are you going to give them a placebo? I think most of us can recognize that's probably not very ethical. So what we do is we compare it to the best standard of care possible. So if you compare a drug that's new versus the standard of care, being able to show that that has a superior effect is actually very, very difficult and a financial problem for companies to do. And the FDA makes that very hard by making the criteria for that very, very stringent. And so I think in a roundabout way, what I'm getting at is that companies have to invest a ton of money to develop antibiotics, and the risk for them is very, very high. So I really can't blame them. Now, do I want them to get out of the market? No, but certainly I can understand why the financial incentive may not be there. So there is hope coming down the line. So for instance, The FDA has started to relax some of their criteria for antibiotic development. So now they are looking at specific niches for antibiotics, so these drug-resistant infections that are being passed around. They're looking specifically at those bacteria to try to get companies to invest in those products and to try to target those infections. They're relaxing the criteria for which they're approved. And we've had some recently good developments. So in the past 3 or 4 years, we've had probably a handful of antibiotics that have been produced, which is promising. So from the standpoint of once things get on the market, what can we do as a clinical setting? So my training, I'm a clinical pharmacist. I'm a pharmacist that does research in the laboratory. So, you know, in the clinical setting, we want to make sure that we're using antibiotics effectively. So there's a new term that's been developed for this kind of procedure, and I don't know if any of you heard of it. It's called antibiotic stewardship. Means what it says. It's basically taking infections and using antibiotics appropriately. So using antibiotics in patients that should be using antibiotics, stopping antibiotics when they should be stopped. So, you know, you don't need to treat a patient with pneumonia for 40 days. They only need to be treated for 10 days or 7 days. Stopping therapy is very important and making sure they're on the right antibiotics. And so that's really an important thing. Some of the problem is that where do you think most of the antibiotic use happens, community or in the hospital? This guy's done his reading here. On the farm. That's not an option right now, but we'll talk about most of it. You'd think they would happen in the hospital from, you know, certainly we use very broad, very potent antibiotics in the hospital, but if you look at it from a mass taking standpoint, most of it happens in the community. And we really have no idea from monitoring how much is used in the community setting. You know, being able to be stewards of the community is a really large problem. We have no way to look at that. We have multiple healthcare systems in the community. We have Walgreens, CVS, I don't know, Shopko, other companies that really don't talk to each other. We don't know how much antibiotics patients are using, and it's hard to get a handle on. To this gentleman's standpoint, antibiotics in agriculture are a big, big problem. Now, are we using amoxicillin in animals? No, but we're using some other cillin that's very related to amoxicillin, and so it can really kind of cause a collateral damage effect with antibiotics that are very related to what we use as humans. So that's being addressed as well. So the USDA has started to create guidelines to say how much antibiotics can be used in animals. So anybody know why we use them in animals? You probably all do, right? We make them bigger, right? So it's not to prevent their infection, but there's a process in the animal that allows them to grow up to be bigger animals. I think it's like 30% bigger, 20% bigger by using antibiotics in the feed. So by causing that to go away, it may cause prices to go up, but I think overall as a healthcare system and importance for healthcare, that would be really important. An example would be in Europe, they've actually banned the use of antibiotics in animals, and the USDA is kind of following a similar path. There's just a little bit of legislation headaches that need to be resolved, to put it politically correct in that regard. But it is important, and people are recognizing that, and I think that's something that that's going to happen soon, and I think will help us significantly. So I think I'm about 15 minutes. I guess I'll open it up for questions and comments. I think this is kind of probably more interesting than hearing me blab on about antibiotics overall.
Hello? There, now it goes. All right. I was really interested in when you said that the bacteria makes antibiotics themselves to fight other bacteria. How do you know this? How did you see it? How do they do it? Could you talk more about that?
Sure. So how penicillin was discovered is that they had a mold that they had grown next to a bacteria, and basically the mold prevented the bacteria from growing. So that's really the first concept. When Alexander Fleming observed that in the laboratory and recognized that there is some inhibition properties of that compound or whatever that mold was producing, that's whenever we knew that there was something that was there. So many antibiotics, I can only think of one antibiotic on the market that was developed purely from a synthetical chemist. So they just took a structure and they just created an antibiotic. Almost all of them come from some bacteria. And usually the bacteria that they come from, a common one is called Streptomyces, that you see in the soil. So mining for organisms out of the soil has been very common. But that's kind of resolved, that it's wasting away as far as being able to produce anything new. And so now we're going into the ocean, like deep sea excursions, sponges, and then the insects that I talked about, the UW researchers that have developed a grant for looking at insect relationships to try to produce antibiotics. So that's kind of further down the line. What we're doing now is mostly taking products we know will work, and there's some resistance out there to those products, and then chemists modify the chemical slightly to improve its activity. So you're getting new antibiotics that way, but they're kind of cousins of existing antibiotics. And so what I'm getting at is there's resistance already there, probably to some degree in the bacteria, and it's just a matter of bringing out that resistance with a similar product that's now available. So that's how we know that they produce antibiotics, and the problem is when they're produced in a small quantity, so they're not pumping out like, you know, pounds of antibiotics out of a single bacteria. When they're used in nature, they don't cause resistance. When we use them in mass quantities, that's when the organisms adapt and they basically become the overall population.
Question? Oops. I was prescribed an antibiotic some time back, azithromycin, and it wiped out, decimated anyway, the healthy flora in my gut. And do you have any comments about how you restore that? Because I've been taking probiotics and it really doesn't go back to the status before quite.
Okay, good question. I think that's something that many have experienced as far as antibiotics. So this is the term I referred to earlier. It's called collateral damage. So you're not really, you're treating the infection, but you're also treating a ton of microbes in your gut, and unnecessarily, right? And so that's why you kind of eliminate the good bacteria in the gut and then allow the bad bacteria to overproduce. So there's actually, I was talking earlier, there's actually more bacteria in your gut than there are other cells in the human body. So it gives you a flavor of how much bacteria. I think it's something like 10 or 20 pounds of bacteria are sitting there in your gut. And so by dumping a bunch of antibiotics in there, that is a breeding ground for resistance. So some of the common resistant organisms that we see come from the gut, and then they basically, many organisms in the gut are kind of like, as I was saying earlier, the prostitutes of bacteria. They take on any antibiotic resistance and develop it, and then they spread it out to other bacteria. But to your point about how to prevent it, how do you restore it? Well, don't take the antibiotic would be the first mechanism. But there are some things in the community you can do, so probiotics have been known to do that. There's not a lot of hard evidence to suggest that they're 100% effective, but they're not harmful. So unless you have, you know, unless you have immunosuppression, like you have trouble with getting infections like cancer, if you have cancer or on drugs that suppress your immune system, taking probiotics is not harmful otherwise. So there is a potential benefit. Most of the benefit has been seen in the community. So for patients that take the drugs on the outpatient setting, in the hospital, it's not been shown to be as effective. So one other thing you can do is, if you've had trouble with that in the past, is try to look at an alternative antibiotic. So there's some of them that do not target gut bacteria as well as others. And so that would be another recommendation. But probiotics, I don't know, I think one of them, some of them are like $30, so in some degree you may be wasting money. They may work, they may not work. A cheaper alternative may be yogurt that you could take, as it has a lot of probiotics in there existing. Well, that's an interesting thing. The question is, why not eat poop? So, everyone laughs, but there's actually, that is probably going to be the standard of care for patients in the hospital. So one of the flyers I was passing around, one of the urgent health needs is an organism called C. difficile. Many of you may have heard of that, C. diff. Organisms, and one of the problems is that you take antibiotics, the antibiotics disrupt the bacteria, and then patients develop these C. diff infections because C. diff is in your gut, it's just it's tampered down by other bacteria in a healthy way. When those are eliminated, C. diff is resistant to most antibiotics, they overgrow, causes diarrhea. Now you can treat C. diff with antibiotics because there are some that target it, but the problem is that once a patient stops antibiotics, they're off for a couple weeks, it just comes right back. So that you haven't really resolved the underlying problem, which is you've disrupted the gut bacteria and you need them to get back up to speed to try to actually maintain homeostasis in the gut. So whoever was the first volunteer that did this, but what they figured out is that, well, normal patients have normal flora in their gut and they excrete those in feces. We're going to grind this up and give it to a patient. And usually they have some kind of tube in so they're not actually swallowing it, or they give it by an enema. But actually the patients they're treating are the worst of the worst, so it's like a last resort for patients. And they will fail multiple antibiotics over and over again, and pretty much at that point, patients will be desperate for anything. When you're going to the bathroom like 7 times a day for 2 straight months, they'll do anything to try to cure that infection. And so they tried this, and in like 29 out of 30 patients, it worked. Amazing. And so now what they're doing is they're trying to, for lack of a better term, take out the stool, filter out the bacteria from the stool, and put it in a capsule that you can take. Actually, it's like 30 capsules at a time that you take, but a very effective therapy. And then at UW, and many major medical centers now do stool transplants. And so they'll take a donor that they screen for things like HIV, hepatitis, to make sure they're not giving that to the patient. But they'll screen that patient for those diseases, have a donor that donates, as you can guess, and then give that to the patient, and that's their treatment. It's $1,500 if anyone is interested in it. Not, you don't be paid as a volunteer, but $1,500 is the cost. I think, yeah.
My question is tame compared to that conversation. I was just curious, you made a comment earlier about there'll be, you know, some humans that just are not going to be able to resist the infection that they're facing. Is there any aspect of that that is about that particular human's genetics or physiology, or is it just the microorganism and the antibiotic?
That's a very good question. I think there is some aspect. So the area of personalized approaches is really the new frontier. We know that some patients with a specific mutation are more likely to develop an infection. So there are certain things that we know can predispose patients to an infection. One is they have some kind of dysfunction in their genetic system, or they are on drugs that can cause this to happen. So I think that is the case from the resistance standpoint. That's really not something that's been shown that I know of. But there are some things that can drive resistance in the host themselves. So one of the things is that our own bodies produce antibiotics. They're called peptides, and they work by attacking the bacteria. They see a bacteria, they attack it, and then all the white blood cells go to attack the bacteria from recognition of these peptides. Over a course of time, if a patient has been infected for a long period of time, what happens is that they become resistant to these peptides in the patient, and many antibiotics actually work like those peptides, but on steroids. They're just much more potent antibiotics, but they develop resistance to these peptides, and over time, even though a person hasn't seen that antibiotic, they develop resistance because their own body is creating that resistance to the organism to that antibiotic, just because it's been around for a long time. So things like bone infections, prolonged skin infections, things that take a long time to treat, is when you see those kinds of things happening. So it's really fascinating. It's not driven by genetics. It's just driven by the host trying to combat the infection, and it's a similar process to how an antibiotic works.
Since it takes about 3 days to clone a bacteria's entire genome right now, why aren't we using targets against the specific bacterial genome as an antibiotic? You could infect them with a virus, do the antisense RNA. The bacteria is dead or non-functional. That's one question. The next question is, our current health food industry has promoted the probiotics as something useful. None of these bacteria that they're promoting are normal in our guts. Why would we ever think that that would be useful? No study has ever shown it to be useful. Why do we prescribe it?
So for your first question, it's very complicated, but certainly the more we understand about the genetics of the bacteria, the whole genome, the more we'll be able to benefit. So from the process of trying to develop a specific like bacteriophage or other thing that can target an infection, you know, we have antibiotics that work against DNA. They work and then they stop working. So there are some that do a very good job. It's just it's been very difficult to manipulate the DNA of the organism for that target, because at that point you may have some problems with the host. You know, if there's a similar process in the host that you're trying to stop, that also could be a problem. So like cancer drugs are actually anti-infectives too, that they work in human cells to kill human cells. So you know, there could be some cross problems there. So that could be one barrier. The second issue on probiotics, meaning they're not common things that you would see in the human gut, is correct. So the things things that are in common over-the-counter probiotics or in yogurt are not things that are seen in the human gut, but they don't cause harm, and they allow the other bacteria to try to settle in the environment because they can be overtaken by common organisms in the gut. So they basically take up space for C. diff or other problematic bacteria until the host can return to its normal cycle. So that's a good question, but not a lot of hard evidence to say they work, and that's probably why. Yeah.
Another question? We talk about stewards of antibiotics, and are there examples? Can you give examples where communities have done this or institutions have done this? Because you see, you know, if your kid's crying all night and you come in, your ear infection, you get an antibiotic. If your sinus has been going, you get an antibiotic. I mean, most of us will go in if we're miserable enough and we'll get an antibiotic. Do you have any examples where studies have been done where they've actually been good stewards and it's been helpful?
That's a good question. Some of it is involving the healthcare team following up on those patients. So I mentioned earlier that how antibiotic resistance is created from an organism standpoint, but causing it to happen, there's two things that cause it. One, you use antibiotics for a long time and the bacteria evolve. And the other is just using them not long enough. So there's kind of a sweet spot to when we should be using them. So from the community standpoint, I think it's important, and I'm biased here because I'm a pharmacist, but pharmacies should be calling these patients during the process of treatment to make sure they're taking their medication. I think that is important. Many patients stop using antibiotics for like a sinus infection once the symptoms go away. And that's a problem because the infection hasn't been treated yet. You still have bacteria that could recur because of the lack of complete treatment. So, you know, long-term treatment causes problems and short-term treatment causes problems. From the institutional standpoint, so in the hospital, they recently the CDC and the FDA are recommending that hospitals have what we call antibiotic stewardship programs. So they have dedicated teams in place that monitor the use of antibiotics and make sure antibiotics are used effectively in patients. So this usually consists of an ID physician, a pharmacist, typically an infection control nurse, and the microbiology lab, and many others that fill in the gaps, but those are the four main components in hospitals that are needed to run these programs. And what they're looking for is, you know, for patients that need antibiotics, they're getting them. They're getting them for the right amount of time, and they're not underusing them as well. So there's a lot of things that go into that. And trying, what we're trying to do is maintain the antibiotic pipeline that we currently have. So there's a lot of things that, a lot of antibiotics can treat a lot of different infections, but a lot of times it's just overkill. And so getting patients off things they don't need is really important. So to the point of, from a hospital standpoint, actually soon, like California, for example, has legislation in place that says they must have antibiotic stewardship teams in every hospital. And usually what that requires, as I mentioned, the ID physician, but pharmacists have to be trained in anti-infectives. And that usually requires 2 years of additional training after graduation. And there's not enough pharmacists trained in that area to be able to deliver that into hospitals. So, you know, there's a significant need versus what is being required in those institutions. It's helping, but we have a long way to go.
I'm not sure how, is it making? Okay. I'm not sure how to say this, but normally we're looking at the host, the human being, being infected by bacteria and viruses. are there host human beings that are being studied who naturally, or there's something unique about them that they're resistant? Are there studies being looked at across around the world?
Resistant to infections?
Yeah, but specific infections.
There's been some things in the news and in studies about patients being resistant to HIV. But from a bacterial standpoint, not that I know of. I mean, patients may have more of a risk of getting an infection than others, but as far as a particular aspect in a person that can resist an infection, not that I know of. Just, you know, the healthier you are, the more likely you are to resist an infection happening. But from a gene or a, you know, a issue in the host that's unique, I don't know of any.
Can you hear me? Okay. With all the antibiotics that both livestock and people are consuming, and then that's got to go somewhere eventually, and then it goes into the groundwater, and then how much of that do you think gets back into our drinking water, and do they test for that?
I don't know the exact percentages of what would go back into drinking water. I know they've tested and they're in there for sure. I think there's been some things you can find on the web about, you know, antibiotics being in drinking water, so they are there, and it's due to either patients flushing the medications down the toilet, which don't do that, or livestock runoff and things like that. So again, it's in the livestock situation, they don't use antibiotics that are human, typically not human antibiotics, but they use things that are very similar to what we would use in the person. So the bacteria have seen similar products that are a problem. But the exact percentages, I don't know that answer, but it's been detected, and people have had a direct relationship between animal livestock resistance and a person getting an infection that's in close contact with the animal. That's happened. So you can see that.
A question back here.
How about the effectiveness? Is it working? Effectiveness of antibiotics for flesh-eating bacteria.
Okay, so for those who didn't hear, so the question is on flesh-eating bacteria. So the term flesh-eating bacteria is can be many different kinds of organisms. There's a couple that can cause flesh-eating bacteria. Quite honestly, antibiotics are not the treatment for flesh-eating bacteria. It's really surgery to try to, you know, it's spreading up the arm. You stop it by cutting off the skin and preventing that from going up. But antibiotics play an important role. They slow the spread of the disease. But what the person's not going to be cured by antibiotics because it's too fast. For the organism is going up the skin too quickly for that to be slowed down by antibiotics to stop it. So patients need surgery for that infection, but antibiotics slow down that process. And there's not a lot of resistance for the typical organisms that cause flesh-eating disease. Those are things like streptococcus and a different kind of clostridium that usually cause that. And they're usually very susceptible to antibiotics. It's just that it has a hard time slowing it down because it just happens so quickly. And so you think it's resistance, but it's actually not. It's just a fast process. But antibiotics work to slow it down.
I think in the last couple of weeks, Tyson Foods said they're going to stop using antibiotics in animals. But they're still going to use antibiotics that humans don't use, from what I understand. Is that true, and is that a big deal, or is that just window dressing for the corporation?
Well, I think it's good that they're moving in the right direction. So it's true, yes, they're going to stop most antibiotics or all antibiotics that are used in humans that would be used in livestock or in animals. But I don't know that that's really going to solve much because a lot of the things I mentioned earlier, they're cousins of things that we're using, like tetracyclines you might have heard of as a common antibiotic. There are a lot of tetracycline derivatives that they use in animals. A lot of penicillin derivatives that they use in animals. So, I mean, it's good that they're moving that way, but it would be better just to shut down the whole process.
That somewhat gets at the overuse of antibiotics or getting it when you're not needing it. But what about also all of the use of antibacterial? You know, every place you go, you know, to wash or to do anything, they suggest you use antibacterial. Is that can that be harmful at some time where you've killed so much bacteria, or is any amount of bacteria good for you?
Well, it depends on what we're talking. Are there good bacteria? There are good bacteria. So to speak to things that bacteria can be good for the environment is, all, is you know, things in your gut are very good for you typically, and you couldn't live without them. But from a hand gel standpoint, I think that's what your comment was, right? Things like alcohol gels. How many of you have one in your purse or in your pocket right now? So quite a few. I used some on my way up here just to, you know, clean myself before I came into the room. But they do they have an important function. So obviously they're very effective. So usually an alcohol gel needs to have 70% or 69% ethanol or some kind of ethanol derivative for it to be effective, like isopropyl alcohol or other things like that. So 69% is the magic number for it to be effective. And they're pretty effective. So organisms cannot survive usually in an alcohol situation of that degree. So they work effectively. There are problems, though. So I think, as I talk to a lot of people about this, sometimes it can be used as a crutch. So you think that you've gelled up your hands, you're free of bacteria. But there are cases where they can survive on the hands. So things like bacterial spores can survive under alcohol, which are in the pre-germination phase, and that's C. diff. That's how that organism spreads. So in the hospital setting, you see these all over the units, which is great, but actually hand washing is better for you. Multiple studies have shown that hand washing without using soaps that are anti-infective soaps, just using standard soap and water, is actually more effective than alcohol gels. And the main reason for that is usually the rubbing of the soap dislodges the bacteria from your skin and the dirt from your skin, whereas things like alcohol gels just kind of rub it around and clean off the surface, but there could be things in the crevices that survive.
And a little bit of a follow-up. I just read a recent article, and I think a lot of people in this room, like myself, live in a home that's on a septic system. And they were talking about in that article how bad the antibacterial soaps are for the septic systems because it's killing the good little bugs in there that we need to get rid of it. Is there any truth? Does that even make sense to you?
Well, I can't. It would. It's kind of a similar process to the, you know, I would imagine the human gut. So I don't know much about the septic system. So I'm assuming that they need. We talked a lot about poop today. That really wasn't my intention. I assume that septic systems need a degree of bacteria in order to function. Is that what you're saying? So soaps, antibiotic soaps contain triclosan as their typical ingredient. And there's been resistance to that that's developed. And there's studies that have shown that you don't need that in a soap for it to be effective. It's the process of scrubbing the surfactant that's in the soap can kill bacteria on their own. And you don't need some kind of antibiotic in there to do that. But thinking about what we talked about in the human, where you take an antibiotic and it causes disruption in the gut, certainly I could see that with an antibacterial soap causing problems. It seems to me that you'd have to use a lot of it for what a septic system can hold, but I imagine if you use enough of it, it could be an issue.
I'm going to take advantage of having the mic here for a second. So I'm just going to play devil's advocate. Are you ever in awe of what these bacteria have accomplished and sort of feel sympathetic towards them? They're just trying to make a living too, right?
Yeah, right. Well, they don't scream when you touch them with an antibiotic, if that's what you're indicating. But it is really amazing to see resistance evolve overnight. You can take a certain antibiotic, like a penicillin, a very simple one, expose them to like MRSA, typical, you know, super bug strain, and you can see resistance evolve within an 8-hour period. So like evolution on steroids, it's pretty amazing to see that. No, I don't feel bad for them. I try to kill them as much as I can.
You talked about some of the pharmaceutical companies stopping the production of antibiotics. Does the government have any kind of incentive or subsidy to encourage the development, the production part of it?
Yeah, subsidies for pharmaceutical companies are always a shadowy business, let's put it that way. So the things like, you know, producing a very like similar compound can extend the patent of that pre-existing compound. So things like Prilosec and Nexium are really the same drug, but they change the drug to change a patent life. So those kind of things happen, but the FDA has actually, because of the limited development, they're trying to get these companies like Pfizer, who have so many resources, to put together an army of people to create antibiotics. They're trying to get them back in the game. So what they've done is they say, well, if you develop a new antibiotic, we will extend the patent life of a big blockbuster medication like Lipitor. So that's, I mean, I don't know if that should be done, but if it gets them back in the game, that's really important. Other things that they've done is that they've allowed things, like I mentioned this a little bit earlier, but they don't have to go through the full approval process. They have to show that it's now safe in a patient, a new antibiotic, and that at least in the lab or in an animal, it will treat a specific infection. So one of these, like, one of the flyers going around was a term called carbapenem-resistant Enterobacteriaceae. It's called CRE. You might have heard of that in the media. It's a superbug organism. And any of you heard of this story out of UCLA that talked about endoscopes being contaminated with bacteria? That was CRE. And so the problem is they're resistant to carbapenem antibiotics, which are the most potent antibiotics we have available to treat them. So basically nothing works. So the FDA is allowing companies to go after treating these specific type of infections and not needing, you know, a full safety efficacy evaluation that typically is done. Now, is that scary? It could be, but it's actually a very important medical need. And as you look at the flyer that goes around, it's not a ton of patients per year that need them. It's about 2,000 or 3,000 patients a year that get infected with this organism. So you're not going to use them at every patient. You're going to use them as a targeted approach. So they're developing that to be able to have companies produce antibiotics that can target a specific infection type. So that's somewhat of an incentive.
Do they do any research on the International Space Station as far as looking at how to kill these guys?
On the space station? Not that I'm aware of. I haven't seen anything come out of that, no.
What about the salve that was found, that recipe for it from that old English text? And as far as researching more texts on the methods from, what, 1200s or even before that?
Okay. So the question, for those of you aren't familiar with this, so there was this report, it was probably 2 months ago now, maybe a month ago, something like that, on this product that some English researchers had used, like oxtail and a couple other medicinal products from like the 1200s that had shown some activity against skin infections. I'll just say as a disclaimer, when you see something out of the media, not that I have to say this, always read the fine print, because the headline said, cure for MRSA. Reality is they never tested it in a human. They hardly have ever tested it in an animal. All it does is it kills bacteria in a test tube. So just always read the media reports. But it's important, I think, if we go back and look at old cures, I think we're not going to use a 12th century sludge of things that they put together, but there may be components out of that they could use as a formulation process to improve what we have in the existing pipeline. So another example was there was a product out of researchers out of Northeastern University in Boston that was a cure for MRSA, and they basically used it in like a mouse and in a test tube, and is probably 20 years away from being on the market. So just take those things with a grain of salt when you read them in the newspaper.
You mentioned earlier with your talking about MRSA that it can be self-limiting because it takes so much energy for the bacteria to have that resistant property. If a loved one has MRSA, how many of the other significant others have to really take precautions that they don't become infected by it?
Okay, good question. So MRSA is a common skin infection that patients in the outpatient and in the hospital can get, but there's differences between what happens in the hospital and in the community. So I said that in many cases, you know, bacteria have only so much space on their genome to put something, and then when they have a bunch of antibiotic resistance, they have very little space to, you know, do their daily functions of life. There are a few exceptions. One of those is MRSA. So they can be both what we call very virulent and also very antibiotic resistant in the same capacity. So that's a little bit of an exception. But in the case where a patient, that a loved one or someone you're living with or in close contact with has that organism, I don't think you need to go under barrier precautions if that's what you're indicating, but certainly, you know, they need to have good protection of their own skin to prevent, you know, transmission or environmental contamination onto other surfaces. The risk to other people is very low. Now, could you become contaminated with that organism? It's possible. So it could get, you know, onto surfaces, and it could get into your nose and live there normally. So probably about 10% of you have staph and MRSA in your nose, probably me, mostly me included, I would imagine, since I work with it on a daily basis. But it doesn't cause harm. There are certain cases where it just causes problems in patients over time. So I think the contamination risk might be there, but from an infection standpoint, unless a physician tells you otherwise, that you need to, you know, isolate this person. It usually wouldn't be done in the home, however. So I think the risk is very low, but they need to make sure that they're keeping the skin protected and cleaned in the appropriate dressing fashion.
Aside from bleach or some other strong antiseptic, it's impossible to sterilize a surface or internally, and you need your immune system to mop up an infection. Does transplant cause much problems, like in the immune suppression associated with that? Kidney transplant, heart transplant, lung mm-hmm. transplant, et cetera.
Yeah, transplant is a huge problem. So things that we have never seen typically, I think HIV would be a perfect example, suppresses the immune system. Back in the early 80s, these people from San Francisco were coming down with weird infections and cancers that no one had ever seen except in a severely, you know, immune-suppressed patient with cancer or something. So certainly when your immune system goes down, that's the primary thing that we have to fight off bacteria and fungus. So in the case of a patient that's on immunosuppression, really in the transplant patients, they get very odd infections very easily, and particularly like fungal infections are very prominent. So one of the things I passed around was a Canada species flyer, and that's an urgent public health threat. Canada species has been known to be a problematic fungus that is among us. But it causes a problem in those transplant patients because they have no means to fight it off, where normal people do, typically. So, yes.
Do the transplant patients bring it among us?
They usually acquire it while they're in the hospital. Other mechanisms, so a lot of the fungus that you can get are from the environment, so things you can dig up out of the soil can be a problem for patients with transplants. One of the organisms, like Aspergillus, is a common soil organism that typically patients that have high immunosuppression after a transplant, we tell them not to go out and garden and do things like that because they can breathe in the spores or the fungus, the mold technically, from that organism and become infected. So they're getting it from the environment and then also from the hospital just by general things that happen in the hospital. So you have fungus and bacteria in your gut. These get transmitted onto hospital rails and beds and floors, and then that can be spread from patient to patient. So transplant patients are really susceptible to those.
How about really slow-growing bugs like tuberculosis?
As far as an immunosuppressed patient?
Just antibiotic resistance, and why is it such a big deal over the entire world?
Well, tuberculosis in the U.S. is not really a problem. We're at a historic low, so that it is a one of those flyers that I passed around, but as a global problem, it's a major problem. And from a resistance standpoint, one of the reasons is that you mentioned that it's slow growing. So an average bacteria take about 30 to 40 minutes to reproduce. Tuberculosis may take 28 days to produce a second cell from its population. The problem with antibiotics is they typically target mechanisms that allow bacteria to grow. So if a bacteria is not growing, then it's not going to work. And so that's why tuberculosis is a major problem. And we typically have to use like four drugs to try to treat them because of how slow they are in their reproduction. And then that leads to a resistance problem. Where you see tuberculosis as a major problem is where you have high endemic HIV populations. So really before HIV became a major problem, like in Africa, tuberculosis, it was there, but it wasn't to the level that it is now. The patients are very immunosuppressed, and they come in contact with tuberculosis, which the immune system can kind of wall off normally. But without any kind of immune system, you have infection.
I wonder if you could get a little philosophical in a definition of what you mean by good bacteria and bad bacteria. Seems to me that part of that definition is where they are. E. coli is a good example. It's in your gut, but your gut's outside of your body. Mm-hmm. It only becomes problematic when it crosses that barrier. That's one thing to think about. The other thing is some of these bacteria that are doing nasty things are also controlling our population. So to what extent should we be using antibiotics to inhibit them from doing what they're here to do?
I just want to say he's not sympathetic.
Well, I like your interesting point. So anything can cause an infection. If you have an open wound or a bacteria gets out of its normal place where it should be, there's a risk of infection. So the problem, an example here would be like patient goes in for a surgery of the abdomen, everything looks clean, then they have a perforation of the abdomen and the E. coli and things that are in there spill over and outside of the gut, and then immediately you have an infection. So I think I'm not good at philosophical rationing. I'm more of a hardline person, but certainly there is a balance, and I think the stewardship angle that I talked about is kind of some of that balance. So not only from a resistance standpoint for the population, but also, you know, when you treat patients with antibiotics, you could do things to them that don't really benefit them in any way. So they could be cured on their own with an infection and may not need an antibiotic, and maybe you're causing more harm than good in those patients. Not saying you shouldn't take your antibiotics, but I think it's something that the healthcare industry needs to consider when evaluating these types of infections. I hope that answered your question. Again, I'm not much into philosophical things, but...
Excuse me. The second part is why they're here. I mean, if they're nasty, we define nasty as they kill people. Mm-hmm. Is that not part of why they're here?
True. But in the normal, like in the gut, for instance, they usually don't kill you. But yes, there are some things you need to consider that they're playing their own role in their environment, and we're trying to play our role in the environment. And they've been around a lot longer than us. On the order of magnitudes of a lot longer, so in the end, they're probably going to win to some degree. But we'll try to stay ahead of the curve as long as possible.
Carol, I'm going to jump in up here. So we have a question from the online audience. The question is that it seems pretty common to hear people getting infections in hospitals. Is the medical community aggressively addressing this?
Do I need to repeat that?
No.
Okay. In the hospital setting, you have a big problem. One, you have a patient population that probably is either immunosuppressed or they're sitting there with tubes and things all over them that bacteria can get into. And they're also using a lot of antibiotics, so you have a very high degree of antibiotic resistance in the hospital, so kind of a twofold effect. What the medical community is doing is getting to the point of, instead of treating, we're trying to do prevention mechanisms. So novel ways to prevent an infection in a patient by a term we call bundling services, to try to package things together to prevent multiple sticks in a patient or multiple ways to get into the patient, trying to do things like that to prevent organisms from entering the patient. Other things that we do is we isolate those patients that have a very drug-resistant infections, and so things like MRSA, tuberculosis, these CRE organisms that I mentioned. Those are all patients that are isolated from the rest of the hospital. Some hospitals have their own ward for them. Others have a specific room that they will isolate those patients to prevent them from transmitting.
I've had Lyme's twice, which came directly from a tick to me, and I couldn't give the disease to anybody else. So is giving me an antibiotic for Lyme's different than if I had a disease that I could pass on, potentially stronger if I didn't take the antibiotic, to someone else? Whereas with Lyme's, it would either live or die in me. Can you say anything to that?
That's an interesting point. Lyme is not technically resistant to any antibiotic that we would use. So most of them are going to be affected by the antibiotics that we use. Some like tetracyclines or fluoroquinolones would be an example. Doxycycline is probably what you took, right, for that. So they're not really resistant. Some of the problem is they're not completely treated. They either go into a dormant phase or it gets inside an area that the antibiotic can't get to and it reactivates. So that's the long-term problem potentially in patients that don't get cured. But as far as transmitting that organism to another patient, if that were possible, technically there's not resistance to that organism that we see. Now, the problem for that is getting an antibiotic and causing other organisms within your body to become resistant, that is a risk for an entire population. If that you know, well, so that could be technically transmitted somehow, but the risk of that would be very low.
Okay, because I've also had other tick bites where physicians won't give me antibiotics, and I never knew if that really made sense.
Well, just as a follow-up, so they either had a suspicion that Lyme was not a possibility, so Borrelia was not the organism, typically around the bullseye rash that you would see with that infection. So that would probably be an example. I assume you did not have the symptoms or the signs that would be consistent with that. So it's getting to the point of, you know, in the community, not using antibiotics in cases where they should be used, or vice versa, using antibiotics where they shouldn't be. So. It wouldn't be a problem for Borrelia or that organism because you don't have it. The problem would be you could develop problems with the antibiotics. So like doxycycline in the summertime, you can have sun exposure, can cause severe sunburns. There's interactions with other medications that you might be on that could have a problem. And then collateral damage to other organisms, you know, long term could be an issue.
As you look ahead, maybe 10 or 20 years, do you think that the problem of resistance is going to increase to become much more problematic than it is now? Or do you think that we're moving fast enough to get a handle on it? What's your long-term view?
Well, if I would look back 20 years ago, I would say using that model, it's going to be a problem. Because, you know, the things like CRE that I mentioned, MRSA was around, but it wasn't as prevalent as what we see now. C. diff was not a huge problem. It was there, but it was not a major problem. So I think overall you're going to see increases, especially in hospitals, potentially in the community. You're going to see increases. Now, I don't know if there's a tipping point. Actually, for MRSA, they've seen reductions in the U.S. So we've reached kind of a tipping point of about, in the hospital, 60% or so of that organism are MRSA type, and then that's backed off in the last few years. Now it's about 50 to 45%. So we're seeing it go down, but they're historically way higher than anything we've ever seen. So I think maybe because of that example, there's either a tipping point to where the organism wants to live in a different resistance profile or being more susceptible for a certain reason, or we've got probably a more basic approach is that we've just been able to isolate patients better and prevent the transmission. So an example, like in European countries, like in the Netherlands, their percentage of MRSA is about 5% of those organisms, where we're at 50%. So they just have much better mechanisms to control patients, probably because they only have about 40 hospitals in the country, where we have somewhere like 8,000, I think, in the United States. So they're able to isolate things much easier and try to prevent the spread, and we're doing a better job at that. So the hope is that would probably be a better way to control it rather than, you know, controlling antibiotic within the entire population is an issue. It's tough to do. The promise is that we're developing new antibiotics. So we've seen in the last 5 to 6 years, much more antibiotics developed than in the past 20 years. So I think the environment is improving, and hopefully that continues with investments in industry and academia.
At times, the bacteria infection is not causing the problem, the bacteria itself. It's the toxin they release. What are we doing to combat the toxin rather than focus on killing the bacteria?
I think it's both. It's bacteria and the toxins. So it's a dual thing. So for certain organisms like C. diff, it's the toxin. The toxin creates the problem. Your body's responding to the toxin, and it basically over-responds, and you get this really aggressive inflammatory gut infection. The problem with trying to target the toxin is that certain antibiotics you use target toxins. So toxins are produced by proteins, and you can use an antibiotic to target proteins, which slows down toxins, but usually that slows down the growth of the organism. And the best antibiotics we have available, like penicillins, actually target organisms that are reproducing. So if you're slowing down that process, you're actually making drugs that are our most effective work worse. So I think in cases where you want to target the protein, you have to make sure it's not something that you want more rapidly active antibiotics. But that's an important area. It's actually something I'm looking at to look at the balance between what is the optimal toxin reduction and antibiotic activity at the same time. So I think that could have major improvements. The woman in the back mentioned necrotizing or flesh-eating bacteria. So that's a case where preventing the toxin actually would have an important process. So I think it's an individual level, but we know there's antibiotics that slow that down. But can we use a product that just targets the toxin? There's actually some things that are in development for C. diff, for example, that it just targets that toxin. It's an antibody for the toxin that the organism produces, and so your body doesn't respond to the toxin, and you don't have this septic type of picture in patients. So it's an area that's being studied. It's slower in development than antibiotics, but it's an important area.
Whenever I get a sinus infection or bronchitis or something, I go see a doctor and they prescribe, a course of antibiotics and so forth. But about a year and a half ago, I went to urgent care and saw a doctor I'd never seen before. And he said, I'll give you a script for an antibiotic prescription, but I would recommend not filling it if you can. Rather, he said, if you can tough it out for like 6 to 8 weeks, you'll get over it. Plus, in the long run, you'll have a lot less of these. Is this kind of advice that people are normally otherwise healthy should be considering asking their doctors about rather than just going off and taking another round of antibiotics?
I wish everyone had your mindset, to be honest. I have two little kids, and so I kind of just tell them to tough it out if they get an infection. But certainly, I think there's cases where seeing a physician is appropriate. Some of the problems is that that you go, either kids or adults go to physicians and they won't leave without an antibiotic. And I think us as a population, if you think about sinus infections and ear infections, half of them are caused by viruses, not even have anything to do with bacteria. And so understanding that and realizing that the long-term problem of not getting an antibiotic is probably very low. You'll get over it anyway, as you mentioned. But that's a very tough concept, I think, for a community to rationalize, because antibiotics work, right? That's one of the few diseases that you can actually cure with something. And so that's really been ingrained in us that antibiotics are a cure for things. And it's hard to get around that some of them aren't going to work because you're treating something that's not there. So that's a long-term problem in the population that's hard to solve. I mean, not everyone is as educated as you folks in regards to that area. So it's a difficult challenge.
Any other questions?
When you eat meat that's been, the animals have been giving antibiotics, and as a person you're eating that and you are allergic to penicillin, how would that affect you?
Never been asked that before. That's an interesting concept. So most of the time with processing, there would probably be nothing there. Washing off the meat would try to get rid of that, any kind of chemical that's on there. And then just basically cooking it appropriately degrades the penicillin. It breaks it up. And so it's not recognized by you from that regard. So that could be a potential problem, I suppose, but I think that I've never heard of it. Not saying it can't happen, but I've never heard of that happening.
Aren't we making ourselves more susceptible to all these superbugs by our unsustainable agriculture and deodorants and our processed food, and we're killing our normal microbiomes, so it makes it easier for these bugs to take over?
Just by how much we're using? I missed the first part of your question, sorry.
What was the first?
Big agriculture.
Oh, our microbiomes. We're killing our microbiomes, our gut bacteria, our skin bacteria.
Yeah, so
even our soil is being destroyed by our agricultural practices.
Yeah, there's been a lot of work on the human microbiome. So those of you that aren't familiar with it, it's kind of the existing microbiology within the human body. There's actually some nice work that's being done from the perspective of a lot of diseases in patients are actually caused by disruptions in the microbiome, or there's specific microbiomes in patients that have diseases like diabetes and arthritis and things that are different than patients that don't have those. So I think we're trying to get a handle on what we're doing to the microbiome, whether it's our diet that's causing problems, if there's certain diets that improve the microbiome, or whether it's the patient, maybe it's a genetic problem that those organisms live there because there's a genetic issue. For example, like patients that are obese have a much different microbiome than those much thinner. I think there's some, sorry to say this, but I think in people that live in colder regions of the world, they have a certain bacteria that makes them fat as opposed to people that live in warmer climates. So for those of you that are looking for an excuse, we're predisposed, not our fault, to getting fat because of those microbes. So, but that is an important issue that's being studied. I know there's a group out of Marshfield Clinic that's doing some interesting work on the microbiome. And you know, outside of Wisconsin, there's a lot of work that's being done. It's really an emerging area. More to come.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Warren Rose.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks again. Thanks so much to our sponsors, the Monaco Public Library, the Lakeland Badger Chapter of the Alumni Association, and Kemp Natural Resources Station, Trout Lake Station, and our hosts, the Monaco Brewery. So thanks again, and don't forget our next event on June 10th. That's the second Wednesday in June. And don't forget about the field trip the following day. So please go home and sign up for the field trip. Thank you all for coming. Good night. Thanks, it was great.